In 2002, Donald Rumsfeld pledged to pursue additional opportunities to outsource and privatise. The war in Iraq is quite the golden opportunity. For an unprecedented number of private military companies, war in Iraq is booming business. The private sector is embedded in combat, occupation and peacekeeping duties, not subject to standard military disciplinary procedures. Their responsibility is not to pursue US, UN or EU policy, but to make money. American Microphone's Robert Millis talked to platoon leader in Baghdad, First Lieutenant Paul Rieckhoff, about the unprecedented number of private contractors on the ground in Iraq.
Private contractors now are even guarding our military bases, taking the place of MPs domestically. They're all over Iraq. What's the reasoning behind that, and what are the flaws with that, and what do you face on the ground?
Having contractors involved allows you to increase your force structure without impacting the country back home. Because you don't activate another division, you just hire another 40,000 contractors. So right now, in Iraq, there are over 40,000 contractors. That's the second largest force on the ground. Larger than the British, larger than the Italians, larger than the Polish, larger than anyone else. They're doing everything from protection security missions to flipping pancakes and delivering milk. They do a lot of different jobs over there, but their overall, the scope of their involvement is unprecedented. They've never been this involved in an American conflict. There have never been so many people on the battlefield who are there to make money. And the individual may not be there to make money. They may be there because they want to serve their country and they're too old to be in the military or whatever. But that's neither here nor there. The bottom line is there are companies that are profiting from us being at war. And the longer we're at war, the more they make profit. And that fundamentally is troublesome to me. They have no oversight. They don't answer to the same chain of command. If things get tough over there and people start shooting too much, they can drop their weapons and go home.
So if I'm in Iraq, I've signed up for 2 years. I've done 10 months of duty. Mm-hmm. I want to re-enlist. I know I'll be back in Iraq. Or I can go home, sign a contract, go back, make 300 grand using the same skills the next day.
Exactly. I mean, when I got home, I got offers to make $150,000, $200,000 over there doing the same thing I was doing for the Army at like $40,000 a year. So who wouldn't think about it? I don't know how it makes more sense for the American taxpayer to pay a Filipino guy $150,000 to drive a truck when you can send Sergeant Smith from Kansas and pay him $40,000. I don't understand how that's better for our country.
If these military services corporations aren't accountable, surely the White House is really concerned.
My question is in regards to private military contractors. The Uniform Code of Military Justice does not apply to these contractors in Iraq. I asked your Secretary of Defense a couple months ago what law governs their actions.
I was going to ask him. Go ahead. Help.
How do you propose to bring private military contractors under a system of law?
Yeah, I appreciate that very much. I wasn't kidding. I'd pick up the phone and say, Mr. Secretary, I got an interesting question. This is what delegation, I don't mean to be dodging the question, although it's kind of convenient in this case, but never. I really will. I'm going to call the secretary and say, you brought up a very valid question, and what are we doing about it? That's how I work. Thanks. Yes, ma'am.
Comforting. Sleep well tonight, and if you need a bedtime story, might I suggest... Or, and if you still really can't sleep, how about hiring your own private army of sheep? I'm Joanne Colan, and this is Rocketboom.